Hello and welcome to Insight. I'm Natasha Chavaskar. Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton has notched resounding victories in New York, moving significantly closer to their party's nominations. Their decisive win ushered in a new phase in the 2016 campaign. Both Trump and Clinton have fought bitterly for months to keep their rivals at bay. In today's edition, we'll be discussing all that's making headlines in U.S. election campaigning and what's at stake. Joining me on the program today, very esteemed guest with me, Dean of Jindal School of International Affairs, Professor Sriram Cholia. Thanks very much, Professor Cholia, for joining us here. But at this point, Professor Cholia, if I can quickly bring you here, what is really working for Donald Trump and the sort of victory he got in New York, thankfully obliging both Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton? What has really worked for Donald Trump so far?
You know, essentially, what's worked for him is the disrepute that the Republican Party has brought upon itself. Mm-hmm. With its core constituency. They have seized both houses of Congress. They should have been in a position to have, you know, the Republican establishment should have been in a position to promote a candidate who is widely acceptable. Right. But what has happened is essentially there is a kind of a alienation towards the system, as it's called, where people are saying, you know, the grassroots, mm-hmm. especially less educated, lower skilled, working white Americans, mm-hmm. Men in particular, a lot of them are feeling like they are losing jobs because of trade agreements. Mm-hmm. A lot of them feel like there is a conspiracy of the Washington elites.
Right.
And Trump has come suddenly and positioned himself as an outsider, mm-hmm. who's going to clean up the system, mm-hmm. as a big anti-establishment candidate.
Right.
And he's trying to capture all this protest and the anger mm-hmm. that is simmering. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you know, he's also got this whole reality television background. Mm-hmm. So he has surprised a lot of people. I myself wrote him off 6 months ago saying that he's going to be out by now.
So you're saying he's capitalizing on the big American frustration. He's saying that if you are frustrated, I'm equally frustrated. And the whole talk of, though he's not a political mainstream
candidate. So he's like a protest. He's like a protest candidate.
Right, he's a protest candidate.
Unfortunately for the Republicans, in November, if he gets through, he's going to be squarely beaten. But as far as the voters are concerned, right. It doesn't matter. They want to teach the Republican, the GOP, mm-hmm. a lesson.
And in the new world order, where is U.S. really placed in vis-a-vis other countries, you know, be it China, Japan, and also the sort of the big pivot to Asia? We'll talk about U.S. and world also. But talking about immigration, America's demographic is changing. Nearly 59 million immigrants have arrived in the United States since 1965. So immigration is a big issue, and Donald Trump has exploited this issue very well.
Yeah, but this goes both ways, you know, because Ted Cruz, right. who's his nearest opponent, mm-hmm. is partly Hispanic. Mm-hmm. And so Trump's, you know, the populism, as it's called, the right-wing mm-hmm. populism, has limits. Because mm-hmm. if you see Obama's rainbow mm-hmm. coalition mm-hmm. was mainly minorities, women, young people, as well as, you know, these immigrant communities, which voted largely for Obama mm-hmm. twice, mm-hmm. 2008-2012. That coalition, Clinton has more or less inherited that group of voters, the demographics, if you see.
Right.
So she's way ahead. If you see the national electorate, you mm-hmm. know, not these registered voters of each party, mm-hmm. all the polls are showing, CBS, the New York Times, they're showing Clinton is ahead of Trump by 10-15% points, because, you know, the anti-immigrant rhetoric mm-hmm. does not go beyond a certain racist constituency in the American society.
Right.
And America is diverse. Mm-hmm. There's also liberal section mm-hmm. of
section. Which are really the important constituencies, you know, who are going to vote and will really work for Donald Trump versus Hillary Clinton? Also women as a constituency, because the sort of remarks made by Donald Trump, how far the women constituency is going to vote. And in fact, much will be decided once the nominations are done. How do you see the way candidates have approached? And because foreign policy, the first thing we say, it's largely about continuity. So are we going to see this happening in days to come?
Well, you see, if Hillary wins, mm-hmm. she is going to be the mantle, carry forward the mantle of Obama. But she's definitely more hawkish than Obama on some aspects. Mm-hmm. See, what has happened is the perception of decline is linked to Obama's hesitance to use military force. Mm-hmm. And he says, you know, I'm not like a hammer looking out for a nail wherever it exists. Mm-hmm. So his doctrine has basically been to judiciously use military force. Mm-hmm. And there have been major success. For example, they took out Osama bin Laden, and mm-hmm. nobody can forget that.
Right.
You know, as Al-Qaeda has been decimated more or less. Mm-hmm. Of course, doesn't mean that the problem is over. Now we have ISIS. Mm-hmm. So, and then I count Iran and Cuba as major, you know, paradigm shifts in American foreign policy.
Right.
But nonetheless, but nonetheless, the perception of decline, which Trump is capitalizing by saying, make America great again, is based on the notion that power is largely exertion of military might.
Right.
And that has come because historically, prior to Obama, especially under the Bush Jr.,
military,
military force was
the
main way they were projecting power. So Obama has resorted more to, relatively speaking, more to diplomacy. And that is, I think you're right that it is simplistic. The notion of decline is simplistic.
Right.
The figures don't bear out the fact that it's completely crashing down as Trump likes to project it. But I think there is, interestingly, an isolationist streak even in Donald Trump.
Right.
He's saying we let South Korea and Japan have nuclear weapons.
Right.
Why
right.
should we offer protection? You know, right. Europeans are like free riding on us and so on. So what is interesting is that the Obama success, irrespective of the fact that, you know, Trump and Cruz are dead against Obama politically, have crept in the sense that...
But Professor Choi, just for a moment, if we actually think that he actually gets the Republican candidate nomination, the point is that when we're talking about foreign policy, is it just a matter of campaigning? Because there are many things that, you know, you say when you're campaigning, but the world is
for
actually
example,
very different and it's difficult
to
implement these
things. You know, for example, 40% tariffs on Chinese imports, that will lead to WTO legislation, which Trump is totally unaware of, you know? And the US will be like hammered with retaliatory tariffs and American exports will completely nosedive, you know. So these are mostly unrealistic. Making Mexico pay for the wall that he wants to build, I mean, that's outlandish. The Mexicans are laughing about it. So I think at the end of the day, if you see, Hillary is relatively speaking more rational, but I worry that, that there will be a shift nonetheless because she tends to she's more hawkish and conservative on various issues. She wanted to bomb Syria after the so-called chemical weapons issue. She was interested in, you know, full-on attack on Libya. She voted for the unpopular Bush
North
administration.
Korea, South Korea.
Invasion of Iraq in 2003.
Right.
So if you look at her record, it's not looking good. Because 2017 onwards, I fear that America will come back more forcefully in terms of military might, and that may actually grate on a lot of...
But when your economy is... The sort of tacit understanding between United States, also Saudi Arabia, and the funding for the rebels in Syria, it is all actually, you know, the whole plan laid out, even their actions in Pakistan, somehow backfired them in a big way. And then when you talk about foreign policy, the US's approach in the last few years?
Well, I think Obama tried to disentangle from these two major conflicts that he inherited from Bush.
Right.
But the rise of ISIS means that they're back in Iraq now,
right?
More than 5,000 troops. And Afghanistan also, they are using more and more near, although they're supposed to be only advising and training, they're getting into combat again and again now because of the resurgence. So I think these problems will remain and will go into the next presidency. I mean, people can, you know, simplistically say we'll carpet bomb them to oblivion.
Right.
But it's not going to work, you know. The point is you need ground forces, you need local allies, you need to build coalitions. You need to also change the attitude of regional powers, which have played a negative role in many of these conflicts. Pakistan has completely, you know, sullied Obama's plans in Afghanistan.
Right.
Saudi is, you know, spoiling the show in Syria and Iraq. So therefore, you know, it needs actually a continuation of diplomacy and coalition building, which right now in the fray, if you look at it, only Hillary Clinton is capable of delivering.
Okay, India has shared a very cordial relation with the United States in the last few years, and especially in the last 2 years, the sort of response it has received from President Barack Obama and the fact that Prime Minister Modi is likely to visit the United States in a few months from now on. What's your assessment and how important whosoever comes as President of the United States, what sort of relations India can actually expect?
I think the big question will be which way the next president will take the United States in terms of isolationism vis-a-vis interventionism. Obama has tried to be somewhere in between these two extremes. Many people argue that he is basically inward oriented and he's basically a kind of a social welfare president.
Right.
He's mostly interested in, you know, Medicare and, you know, immigrants and, you know, creating opportunities for minorities and those kinds. So he's mostly like a New Deal of Lyndon Johnson kind of thing, but in a 21st century. So the argument has been that he's not been as forceful in projecting power and doing stuff around the world, and he's withdrawn. So I think if Clinton comes, my view is that she'll be much more engaged and will try to use levers of force, mm-hmm. especially vis-a-vis China, because Obama is, of course, the author of the pivot or the rebalancing strategy.
Right.
But in reality, it's not been fully implemented. Mm-hmm. They've never managed to push all their naval assets 60% to Asia Pacific as they had envisaged. Mm-hmm. They're still stuck in the Middle East and other parts of the world. Mm-hmm. So I think Clinton continuity, meaning I think she'll also fast forward some of these things. Mm-hmm. So the logic of containing China mm-hmm. probably will take more prominence mm-hmm. from 2017. Than is the case because Obama has tried to hedge his bets. On the other hand, interestingly, Trump is actually pretty isolationist himself.
Right.
And if you see his policies, if you the sum of it, if you want to make you know a method out of the madness, if there is one, you find that he's largely arguing also that you know the old conservative mainstream republicanism, which is based on projecting military force, building military bases and all that,
right.
is useless and it's bunk.
But our relations with the United States will also be defined much with the way U.S. Shares its equations with Pakistan, because in the last 2-3 years, the way things have shaped up.
Well, on that point, Republicans, Democrats hardly matters, right? Because for them, it's always been, you know, and at the one most Indian nationalists, we all believe that at the end of the day, the Americans, although they don't say it, they still want to keep India under check to some extent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you see the you know, overall, the effect of their policies in the region, even though they have the China containment, on the other hand, they have never, you know, completely given up this Pakistan card, you know, and to some extent they play it in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. They have not been, even Obama administration has not been very keen on involving us there from time to time.
Right.
So it clearly means that, you know, as India rises, they will be wary of us too. But and right now, it is still a confluence
and the Afghanistan
of interest.
Factor. Okay, final comments from you, Professor Cholia. What should we really expect from Prime Minister Modi's visit?
Well, I think he is going to visit a very fragmented America,
mm-hmm.
which is so divided now and polarized. And he's going to see a body politic that is struggling to come up with a new administration.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think in policy direction terms, it's probably too late because Obama administration is now a lame duck situation. But nonetheless, I think the work that's been done last 7-8 years and especially last couple of years under Prime Minister Modi is remarkable, and especially in the defense sector, you know. So economic relations anyway has been booming, but what the defense cooperation shows that a greater degree of strategic trust is coming, but we still have problems with the Americans. And my fear is that, you know, from 2017 onwards, the Americans will, you know, whether it's Clinton, especially Clinton, she's going to be more assertive, and we will need to maneuver our way to capitalize on that without caving into the American agenda for the region, because at the end of the day, we want to be our own great power.
And that's all we have for you in this edition of Inside. Thanks very much for watching. Namaskar.